All right. Hey, everyone. End of day two here. Thanks for hanging in there. My name is Christopher. I'm a product manager at Airbnb. We're going to try to do some justice to DORA metrics here. So I've been at Airbnb about 2 years. I'm a product manager on the developer platform team. Before that, I was at Google for a few years. I was a PM there for CI/CD tooling, things like Google Cloud Build and Spinnaker, where I had a chance to work with lots of different companies, some of them here today, like Spotify and other people like that, working on developer productivity. I'm also a DPE Summit Showdown runner-up, which is one of my more proud accomplishments as well. So I wanted to start with a story. I have two girls, a 2-year-old and a 5-year-old, and we were ordering pizza the other night, which we don't usually do, but for any parents, this was like one of those, we're going to order pizza nights. So I said, you know, what do you guys want on your pizza? And it started out pretty safe. You know, it was like, okay, we're going to do pepperoni, we're going to do mushrooms. This is back in New York City. We recently discovered one of those like choose your own adventure ice cream stores. So my 5-year-old was like, you know, I got this. Let's do maybe some gummy bears on there. We'll do some sprinkles. I kind of got into the act. I was like, all right, maybe do some pineapple, maybe some anchovies, which I explained to her were like little fishes. She looked at me like I looked at her when she said gummy bears. And we sort of said, okay, now like, which of those do you actually want on your pizza? And they sort of said, well, all of them. Well, I want all of them on my pizza. So we sort of invented the everything pizza. And you can imagine how this would have tasted if I let my 5-year-old do the ordering. So this kind of reminded me as I was getting ready for this conference of how a lot of teams kind of approach developer productivity metrics. You sort of have this like, let's just get all the metrics together in one place and everything's going to go great. And that's just really not quite kind of how it works. So, you know, some people already talked about it. I think this kind of is sort of what GitHub was describing yesterday is you know, you start from a place of like, okay, how are we going to measure developer productivity? And so the first thing you do is you ask all the senior thought leaders at your company, like, how would you measure it? What metrics do you think we should record? So it starts out, again, reasonable, like, oh, let's do PRs per developer. You know, let's do, you know, time to 10th PR, because I want to know more about onboarding. Then it gets a little dicier. You know, somebody's like, oh, I really like lines of code. That's what we did at our last company. And then the next person you talk to is like, never do lines of code. That's the worst thing you can do. And it just kind of keeps going. Then there's the person who's like, well, I saw Google did a blog about this metric. We should also do that. And then there's the executive who's like, actually, if you could just like combine these all into a single metric that would just tell me like how we're doing, that would be awesome. What was it? The Grant's talk, like the super metric of, you know, universal value. And then you have like the sort of directors and managers who are like, I don't really care. I just want to know like what to fix. I want something more actionable. So like, you know, this is not going to go well, right? And even after you do all that, so say you collect all the data, you build out all these dashboards, and then you present them, and then it's like, well, so what? You know, did anything change? Are we actually doing anything differently? So we're going to try it a different way. This is where sort of DORA came to the rescue, I think. DORA has a lot of advantages, pros and cons that we'll get into. But one of the nicest things it has is like you get past that initial conversation, right? It's not about opinion anymore. It's research-based. These are sort of as close to industry standards as we have. And so there's a lot of value in just sort of getting out the door and starting to establish some common language. So let's talk about kind of how we implemented DORA metrics at Airbnb. So this is a quote from Nathan, who's part of the DORA team at Google. And again, he's absolutely right. Like it sounds like this is going to be really easy. Lead time. Everybody understands kind of what it is. This is going to be no problem to measure. But when we actually get into the details of it, it becomes really hard. And there are a lot of sort of specifics that you have to work through. So I kind of tell you what we did. And we sort of knew early on that we wanted to measure it quantitatively, right? Like I think, you know, some of you are aware that DORA itself was survey-based when it first launched. But a lot of that was just because that's really the only way an outside company can actually measure lead time at a broad range of companies, right? They can't go to every company and sort of implement instrumentation. Surveys are kind of the most feasible way. But at your own individual company, you know, you can actually measure the actual data. So this is a little bit of what our release pipeline looks at Airbnb. So we have a multi-monorepo architecture. And when you're releasing code in a monorepo, one of the challenges is like, well, when we first started, we sort of were thinking, you know what, we're just going to trace a PR all the way through the pipeline. We're going to be able to tell when a PR was created and when it was released, and that's going to be lead time. And so we ran into issues almost immediately, because what happens is that when a developer creates a PR, you can contribute to multiple services at the same time. And for every service, a different snapshot is created, and then that snapshot is owned by the service team and released via Spinnaker. So a single PR can be deployed multiple times. Not all snapshots are deployed. So what we found is that we sort of lost the ability to trace a PR all the way through. So we ended up kind of taking a different approach. So what we did instead was we kind of split it up. So we looked at the PR portion and then the release portion. So for the PR portion, we said, okay, this is easy. We know when the PR was created. We know when the PR was merged. And underneath that, we could look at more details like how long did it take to get to the first review? How long was it in review? And then how long after it was approved did it actually get merged? Then on the other side, we knew a lot about snapshots. So when a snapshot was created, we knew how long from when it was created to when it was a deployment was kicked off to then when the deployment was complete. And so if you stitch these together, you get lead time. So we didn't actually have lead time for a specific number, but in terms of lead time at the service or team level, this was pretty good. So what did we learn? What we found out was that, you know, at least for us, we kind of had a suspicion already, was that one of the biggest bottlenecks for us was the time from when a change was merged into mainline to when it was actually deployed. So most of the services at Airbnb, like all the actively maintained ones, are being deployed multiple times a day. They're using continuous delivery. But there are a large number of services that are sort of kind of keeping the lights on in maintenance mode that aren't being actively developed, that service owners would deploy less frequently. Sometimes, you know, once a month, once every few months. And so this by far dwarfed like anything else we could possibly tackle to shorten lead time. People were like, oh, we want to make deployment shorter, or oh, we want to like help with build time. But by large, you know, over 85% of actually our lead time for the majority of services was just changes that were successfully merged, waiting for someone to kind of kick this off. Some of our takeaways from DORA, like having implemented this and things like that. One of the biggest values of DORA is just the fact that it lets you standardize on definitions. It gets past some of these conversations of like, well, what do we mean by, you know, X? What do we mean by Y? It gives you a common language for teams to benchmark against each other and also sort of move forward. The other aspect is it's really important to use quantitative metrics alongside qualitative metrics, right? I think there's this hope that when you instrument this stuff, that's all you're going to need to do, right? It's like, I'm going to instrument this dashboard, I'm going to have these metrics, and as long as I keep improving this thing 10%, my company's going to get better and better, and my developers are going to get more and more productive. And what we found is that, you know, the metric, I think it was Laurent was saying, like, you know, all these metrics are flawed in one way or another. So the best way to use these is just as a signal. Like, use your developer survey data, use your quantitative metrics data, talk to your customers, and use that to give you kind of a better picture of where productivity is at and how to improve it. Like, this doesn't absolve you from still using your best judgment and understanding your developers. This is just another signal. The other one is, like, we talked about kind of the so what. Is like, okay, you have this dashboard of numbers, you know, it's an 8. I want it to be 8.5, you know, who cares? One of the things that we went into ahead of time knowing this was that we have, there's like a top-down effort called Commitment to Craft at Airbnb, which sets org-wide goals around sort of shared objectives like staging reliability and things like that. And so when we found out sort of this lag time to deploy number was a big bottleneck, we already had a mechanism in place to get people to improve it. We tried other efforts and other places to sort of get people to kind of organically or voluntarily improve these numbers, and that proved really challenging. Like, people are busy. A couple teams who really cared about it would lean in and sort of improve it on their own. But by and large, if you want these things to improve, you need kind of executive buy-in, monthly updates, and more accountability. So I would, you know, if you're thinking about implementing this or however you use developer metrics at your company, kind of have a plan in mind already around, you know, executives really pushing and driving this change. So another one of the big topics is like setting goals, right? It's like, okay, if we set goals around this, are we just going to gamify it? What we found is that you can set goals around these things, just be careful, right? So like with lead time and lag time to deploy, you know, what we found was that we were kind of like, yeah, go ahead, game it. You know, like, what are you going to do? Like, you know, oh, I'm going to game it just by deploying more frequently. We're like, okay, well, that's sort of the behavior we want. So to the extent you can sort of align your goals with the outcomes that you want. I think that's one of the things about DORA metrics is like, you know, if you're balancing these out, right, where you have like change failure rate, deployment frequency, you know, things like smaller PRs, you know, people are like, oh, people are going to game in and sort of break PRs up into smaller PRs and submit them more frequently. And you're like, yeah, okay, that's good. Like, we want that. Small PRs are probably pretty good. People could take it to extremes, but by and large, you know, this is the kind of behavior that you know, actually want. Sorry. And the last one is, you know, don't boil the ocean. Again, there's, you know, as people talked about earlier, is like there's this temptation to think, okay, we need all the data, right? And so we're going to spin up a team of 10 people, and we're going to get 2 data researchers, and we're going to spend all this time cleaning this data, and then we're going to present this dashboard, and it's going to change the world. And it's really just not how it works. Like, treat this like a product, right? You wouldn't launch a product that way, right? You would launch and iterate. You would launch an MVP. And I think even with DORA, like, all four metrics work together to give you a better picture, but you don't actually need all 4 to be that valuable, right? Like, you probably know your company, where the biggest pain points are. You know, are you having issues with reliability? Maybe we should focus on change failure rate. Are your outages lasting for days and you don't know why? Think about MTTR. You know, for us, we sort of had a sense that deployment frequency was already a challenge. So we kind of started there. And again, that's sort of low hanging fruit. But don't be afraid to kind of just get something out there, get feedback, and then add value over time. I think there's this temptation to kind of over-engineer metrics right out of the gate, which can be counterproductive. So that said, you know, DORA is a step on the journey. It's not the end state. It doesn't answer all questions. So where did DORA work kind of less well for us? And these are sort of common things that people will point out or talk about. So it's not very helpful for measuring the impact of specific projects, right? Like, I think one of the first questions you get when you do developer productivity metrics is like, oh, great, because I'm evaluating these 3 projects and I want to know which one is going to have the biggest impact on developer productivity so I know where to invest resources. That's really hard to do at this level of data, right? Like, these metrics tend to be lagging indicators. They're influenced by so many different factors and there's so much noise that it's really hard to isolate out, you know, specific projects. Occasionally, you'll have something that moves the needle at that level, but it's sort of the exception, not the rule. So it won't answer kind of everything that you're kind of hoping it will. The second is that they're not directly actionable either. Because so many things influence them, really this is sort of the start of a conversation, not the end, right? Because you'll go to a team and you'll say, okay, you know, lead time is slow. Okay, why? Okay, we broke it down. You know, PR time is slow. Okay, why? Oh, build times are too long. Okay, why? You know, and then you start segmenting it by like, okay, is it by framework? Is it by team? You know, is it by how long somebody's been at the company? So almost all of this information is going to need more investigation as you go on. So again, this is a starting point, but there's more work to do. So kind of go in knowing that. And the last part is that it's sort of overly focused on the DevOps pipeline. So again, like, it starts from PR creation time, right? So we kind of lose all the information about local developer loop. It doesn't factor in any of the sort of external factors like focus time or cognitive load. It really emphasizes just the DevOps pipeline, which is sort of a critical but single slice of the overall picture. So what is next? So looking a bit beyond DORA and sort of where we're headed next is incorporating some of the things we just talked about, you know, things like space framework and feedback loops. And then moving to that level below of like, okay, these are the metrics that we really care about, but what are the key drivers below that? And I think that's where I think some of the most interesting conversations are happening, is like, what are those key drivers? So we're starting to look kind of into this more and see where we can find correlations and more sort of actionable metrics, like lag time to deploy was something that was very actionable and drove the outcome that we want. But that's just what kind of one place to start. So if we look at kind of stepping back, sort of the high level outcomes, these are kind of mostly around the DORA metrics plus developer satisfaction, you know, higher frequency releases and PRs, shorter cycle times, you know, fewer customer impacting incidents. And if we look at kind of what the key drivers are and sort of what people, you know, have been finding, is that they tend to fall under kind of 3 buckets. They're sort of wait times. So how long are developers blocked from actually coding and shipping code, either from machine like imposed delays like build times or human imposed delays like waiting for code review? Like, how much friction, how much, you know, downtime is there in a change? The other is like pass rates. So, you know, how often are my PRs passing in CI? How often are my deployments failing, either because things of flakiness or reliability or poorly written code or poorly poor test coverage? Is that, you know, every failure leads to this sort of death loop of like troubleshooting, retrying, recode reviews, things like that. So how can we sort of help developers get past that? And then the last one again is like everything kind of around that. So, you know, how much tech debt is there? How much time are they spending on call? How much time are they spending in meetings? Are they using things like AI-assisted development? How good is the documentation? And so these are kind of a combination of quantitative data, like you can measure how frequently your documentation is updated, and qualitative data, like, you know, how serious is the tech debt at your company? So I think as we look kind of at what's next, this is sort of where we're going, is to sort of complement the outcome metrics with some of these key drivers that teams can drive. And that is my lightning talk on DORA metrics. I think we have a couple minutes for questions, if there are any. Thank you.